So the reason a lot of people are not having proper seating is because Justice B.N. Srikrishna is here. And he's the crowd puller. We didn't have any. We thought on a Saturday on Janmashtami.
Lord Srikrishna.
So, as I complete the entire sentence. But a lot of people are curious to actually learn more and to also see that from the date the report and law was first proposed, there has been a vast amount of time, there's been a lot of conversation around these issues, and there's a huge amount of interest today, and it continues to build as to what will be the future course of data protection. But even much more largely, what role should law play in a digital society? And I think there can be nobody better than Seema to actually have this conversation with Justice Srikrishna, because Seema was also following the right to privacy case very closely from the very beginning. She knows the particular context in which the privacy ruling came, and she understands its value and recognition. Now, as we look towards legislation, but much more broadly as how the courts are looking at the Puttaswamy judgment, I invite both of them for a conversation. And we've set up two chairs. We are not calling it a fireside chat. We are reserving time for this conversation here. We will take certain questions, which will be through Seema. So if we can have a sense of the room, and please, no comments, please. I really request. If comments are not made, if direct questions are made, and Seema can possibly collect that at the end for about 5 minutes and pose some of them to Justice Srikrishna. Justice Srikrishna, we are honored to have you amongst us today, and we are looking forward to hearing from you.
It's a pleasure always to talk to you, and thank you very much for everybody who's here on a weekend. And Justice Srikrishna, I mean, even if I launch on a really long introduction, it won't be sufficient, so I'll keep it like really short. He's a man of many parts, as you know, the landmark kind of gold standard of a report on a very disturbing moment in Mumbai's history, the Bombay riots, which Justice Srikrishna did. He's had a lot to do with people's salaries. He's done more to better them than most people I know. And of course, his latest thing, which makes him very interesting, is his work with on data and on privacy and tackling a lot of thorny issues, which came up after the government appointed him as chair of that committee. So we hope to kind of talk about some things, Justice Srikrishna. And I mean, we've had a formidable panel and a lot of conversation, and it's a tough act to follow, but would you want to just reflect very briefly on how you look at privacy and how do you define it, and particularly in the Indian context?
Thank you, Seema. As a person who came to me very first day I was in Delhi for this and started grilling me, I'm happy that you are still here to shoot questions at me. People have a wrong notion that I exist because the state wants me to exist. No, it's the other way around. I am the center of democracy, and state is something that I have created in order to ensure that some of my rights are protected by a third party. Now, if you apply this to any law, your solution is automatic. Now, come down to data protection or right of privacy. If you remember, how did this whole debate start in this country? We used to have this problem earlier, way back, the Supreme Court had decided a couple of judgments, all arising out of police surveillance of notorious criminals or previous convicts or something of that sort. Now, that was the good old days when people did not talk in terms of digitization. It was just a question of a police constable stalking you all the time or standing outside your house and taking photographs of that kind of thing. But today things have changed. So digitization has empowered people. Now, as a result of this, the government in its, let's say, very beneficial mood wanted to make a lot of stuff available to citizens. So it said, we'll collect data about all of them. How do you collect data? You have no way of collecting data. So let's issue an identity card to every citizen. This is how it started. If you remember, when this issue was first mooted by the UPA government, there was a lot of tussle between the Ministry of Home, Home Ministry, then the Finance Ministry, each saying that, hey, PAN cards are always doing this work, why do you need something more? Then there was this concept of National Register also, which was being mooted by the Home Ministry at one time. So because of this, the Aadhaar thing did not take off at all because of the interministerial conflict in the government. Subsequently, when the new government took over, they pushed it forward. They pushed it forward, putting it to us that, hey, I need this data. Why do I need this data? Because I want to empower each citizen. Now, the motive is good, but the question is, how does it pan out on the ground? That is important. Now, when I started this, I kept saying from day one till day X when I finished it, that, hey, look, are we now creating something that is going to gobble up the person for whose benefit we are making? Now, what should be done in order to ensure that this does not turn out to be a Frankenstein ultimately? Now, I and my committee, I was able to persuade them that whatever our thinking is, let us put it before the public. So first we had the report. The white paper, we call it the white paper, and a lot of debate was there. I was called a fool, and somebody called call it a white paper. I said, I don't care, it's a white paper. It was white, really white, fortunately. Not the yellow
paper. It had some ink on it, yeah.
Not the yellow thing that the government normally produces. It was a white paper. What did we do in the white paper? We looked at all that was happening in the different jurisdictions. America, of course, didn't have any law worthwhile until the California, state of California came out with a law, I think, about 2 months ago. It was completely confusing. Looked at England, GDPR, then South Africa, Singapore, whole lot of Australia and all that. And then let's say, this was exactly the exercise that was carried out when the Constitution of India was drafted, if you remember. That is how we look at the Mahabharata tells that you collect, like the bees collect good things, you collect it and make it your own. That was the whole purpose of doing it. And then the question that arises is, we have done all this, let the public understand what your tentative thought process is and let them react to it. Therefore, the committee went and had interactions with the public in 5 or 6 metropolises. And everybody was invited, right, from academicians to technicians to law students to economic graduates and people like that. And after taking inputs from them, we churned out the input. Of course, the inputs varied from it is all bakas to it's very important. So, I mean, you take whatever is good from it. Then we produced a report. And there I said, let's not stop here. Let's tell the public at large what is the tentative nature of the bill that should be there. Because otherwise, you know, reports have a tendency of going onto the shelves and gathering dust. Now, this is the framework of the law, let there be a draft bill. The intention was, the draft bill would also be in public domain and there would be debate on that and there would be inputs. And ultimately, of course, there would be debate in parliament, and I expect a complex subject like this, there should be some reference to a select committee, evidence taken before the select committee and things like that.
Well, as long as not needed no money bill, we don't know. But you came to this report, the draft report, and you had parameters laid down. You have a government draft now. How happy are you with the parameters that you set out? And especially with security of people's data. How secure is the data of Indians going by the draft as it exists?
See, the point, when you talk of security, two aspects arise. One is, how technically sound is the security? Now, that's a question which the technical people will be able to answer. And the question, other question is, even assuming it is technically secure, does the government treat it as a tool for being the big brother breathing down your neck all the time? Now, that is possible. As it was being mentioned, all laws which are intended, ultimately government tomorrow want to know. We want to see how many children are exploited for sexual traffic. So let's collect the data of all the persons. Let us collect the data of all the prostitutes in the country. Ultimately, it will work against them. I agree with the speaker. I don't know her name. I see her right from here. That's the correct concept. You want it, but then there should be ring fencing that it is not likely to be used precisely for the opposite reason. This is one danger that I envisage. Therefore, if you remember in our private debate also, I said the best way of solving this is to have somebody very, very responsible vet the data. Now, when I had a debate in the discussion in the committee, I was told that normally the secretary of the department will take care of this. I asked the secretary of the department, he said about this wiretapping business. He said in a day, in about 500-600 matters come to me. So I said, do you really have the time, patience, or the ability to run through and say, otherwise you see what happens under the criminal procedure code. Criminal procedure code requires a judicial application of mind that there is some case made out. Then, yes, probably, yes, there is this fellow is a terrorist finder or he is a criminal. Therefore, I allow this warrant by which he can be surveyed, by which his residence can be raided. Of course, nowadays that's not happening that way. So that's the presumption at least. Now, reverse it. If it is in the hands of an executive, which executive in this country, at whatever his level, whether he is the cabinet secretary down to the desk officer, will go ahead and the government wanting to do it. The government wants to take my data. But let me tell you, do you think data is not being collected today? Forget the data privacy bill. And the telephone from somebody, data is just taken away. Therefore, it is necessary to have a barrier. This is an act that empowers citizens, not because you get benefits under something or the other. It makes sure that your privacy remains with you.
But are you confident that in its present form, it's adequate?
I'm not very confident. In fact, I was mooting from, of course, being biased in favor of judges, that there should be a prejudicial determination. But then the answer given to me is, if secretary has 500 matters and he can't handle it, the judges will never be able to handle it. See what is happening in the regular cases. Okay. So I stepped back and said, yes, but make sure that you do not have access unless there is a parliamentary act which permits you to do, in which case the parliamentary act would have to say who can do it, for what purposes, under what circumstances, and what is the method of doing it. Just like today, for example, you are infringing the personal right of a human being under Article 21 by preventive detention. See how preventive detention has been put into a straitjacket. I was hoping that something like that would come. Then the other alternative was something like the FIFA court in the United States. But when I studied it, I said it doesn't make really any sense because it's a very secret chamber where things are done, and right, RDI people have no access to that at all.
Yeah, so I'll just very quickly watch your comments on a few things and then we'll throw the floor open for questions. The whole question Amrita raised about the RDI versus privacy, and it's sometimes perhaps mistakenly seen as two sides, whereas both are, the intention is to empower the citizen. Now, we increasingly have a situation where my right to know what the government is doing is increasingly being scaled down, and the right of the government knowing what I'm doing is increasingly going up. How do you see this huge asymmetry that's come in?
Yes.
The weakening of the RTI and the extreme kind of on high surveillance of individuals.
The only exception under Section 8,
yeah,
J, I believe, 81J or 82J, under the RTI is that personal data is not allowed to be accessed unless there is another exception to exception, that the person who is doing that, the officer, comes to a conclusion that it is overwhelmingly necessary in public interest to do it, or that this information is already available in public domain. This is precisely what the drafted bill also said. When we said it, we did not say that it overrides RTI in any way. No, you will notice, if you carefully look, I don't remember the section number, but it says this very same exceptions have been put in the bill also. Now, to turn this into a situation of RTI versus right to privacy is an absurd one. And I don't think that is a correct way of going about. And I'm not sure. Look, today I do not know what is the government stand. Have they moved a bill and said this is the official version of the bill? So what are you talking about in the government version? I don't know what the government version
there's
is.
There's a draft version up on the net. But yeah, we have no clarity on...
I don't know. I gave a draft bill to the government and said, hey, this is what the public has been asked to respond to. Thereafter, what happened? I also was surprised that particularly on data localization, there was so much lobbying that they have really put the whole thing on its head. So I'm
you're not happy with data localization, which the way the government is handling it?
No, I'm not happy with the way a number of things that the government is handling.
Coming now to another related question on ability of citizens to kind of manage their private lives, is this question of CCTV. Now, it is seen as a very useful thing to politically put out that, any crime against women, children, whatever, we'll put up CCTVs and that seems to end it. But the laws around the using of that footage, the fact that market associations seem to have unhindered access at all kinds of... How worried are you about this whole CCTV
business? I'm damn scared about it because feminists are arguing that marital rape should be stopped. So for that purpose, how do you stop? Put a CCTV in my bedroom? Yes, it should be stopped by a method that does not impinge upon my privacy. Now they want to know, they want to give you security, ensure that all your valuables are properly placed. CCTV in my room, give me security. I remember.
So how do we sort of put some good sense in these funny solutions that governments come up with?
That is why the point today is, I would have said about some time ago, I have not even specified the timeline because that might give an indication to what I have in my mind. Some time ago, I would have said, hey, whom do you trust in this country?
Okay, with that kind of very visual pointer, we had this conversation earlier when I think the committee was meeting about, who do you really protect your privacy from? The whole private sector question or the government sector question?
Look, the private sector always has been indulging in surveillance because of competition.
No, 1 minute, Dr. Srikrishna. There is now, of course, a situation when you have one private sector operator who's very big on the, on the telephony thing, who will soon be controlling data, who controls, the network on which that data travels. So how does one secure data from government and private sector? If I remember correctly, you were very concerned about the private sector's untrammeled kind of access to data. The government also put out in its economic survey chapter 4, its kind of thoughts on data, which is very touchingly titled by the people and for the people, etc. But it goes on to talk about how this, it should also be made available for commercial reasons. It must all be put together. It must all be actually together and put in one place. So that it's, on the grounds of convenience. It also cites the Andhra Pradesh experiment. So how do you look at the government's kind of stating clearly what it thinks about what it should do with people's data?
What that chapter on data privacy and whatever they call it, data of the people, for the people, by the people, and for the government.
Some Lincolnian.
That last is mine. See, they have said, essentially in one of the paragraphs, they have said that today also there is data being collected. Now data is being collected by different agencies of the government, and they are in silos. So that traditionally we all know in the government, the left hand doesn't speak to the right hand. So one silo will not speak to another silo. So the same data may be collected by the education department, by the agricultural department, and traffic department, and some other department. Now isn't it better if we have it all together so that we can give you the benefit of our wisdom? Now that's a very nice way of putting it, it's very attractive, very seductive way of putting it. But then look at it from the point of view of the citizen. It's bad enough that I have to give you this data, give it in quadruplicate when it is not necessary. And that man comes and says, you give me this data. Now all of you are going to put it in that data, so what remains of me? Nothing remains with me. So all my data is in your pocket. So it's a dangerous situation, I would say. It's a dangerous situation. If you remember, we had this debate long ago, that the difficulty is not collection of data. Particularly with regard to Aadhaar, if you remember.
Yes.
The difficulty is, if you can collect the data, you can profile human beings. You can profile human beings, just like, for example, now, it was being argued, and rightly so, that DNA, of course at the point of time DNA database in this country is not a very, even such a worthwhile thing. But fingerprints, if you remember, fingerprints are collected of all the persons who happen to be unfortunate enough to get into the police station. Now, the crime bureau, what does it do? Anytime a fingerprint is lifted from a spot of crime, they tally it and say, oh, it matches, therefore there's a likelihood of this person being a criminal. Now, this is one way of doing it. It's better, isn't it? If everybody's citizens is there, all the citizens in the country should have their fingerprints. So anytime any fingerprint turns up, I know who has committed the crime. So similarly, if the DNA of all the citizens is there, then you know exactly. But then look at the flip side of that. So my fingerprints being there, and if somebody does some goof up, somebody deliberately does a mismatch, I'm the one who's going to be sent into the gallows.
Even with elections, I mean, the other place where data and elections, you know, we're seeing a lot of connectivity and we don't know the full picture. There was a drive to sort of link Aadhaar with electoral rolls. And there is a good case to say that, you know, somebody who's not a citizen of India should not, you should have a clean electoral system, shouldn't be voting, etc. But how sanguine are you about the idea that the electoral rolls should be matched with everything? Should
so
there be a possibility?
You will have a, instead of having a Cambridge analytics, you will have a Delhi analytics or Mumbai analytics or Calcutta analytics. That is the danger. That is, are we now happy with what Cambridge analytics did? We made so much noise about it. We called them all kinds of bad names. Now you will have that in your own country, in your backyard. I don't think that's a good idea. If I would immediately trust the election commission with its muddle-headed ways of doing the confusion they create, and every time my name is spelt in wrong way, my address is wrong, but still I'm happy. I'm not in the hands of
the reassuring. Yeah. Yes. So shall we move to questions?
Amma,
you want to just take the questions?
And just one more thing, if you don't want to take the mic, you can write your question down on a piece of paper and share it with us.
You can also anonymize it.
My name is Aditi Agrawal. I'm from Media Nava. Thank you, sir, for being here. My question is that should community data be part of the Personal Data Protection Bill, as the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology is already considering? What's your opinion on that?
Yes, we had recommended that community data should be available to every one of these citizens. Now, for example, community data means what? The data that is put into the net by individual. So, for example, take your Google Mac. That's a community data. So it should be available to everyone, and everyone should have a right to access that. Not the government. We have not said that the government has a monopoly on that. Every citizen says, what is happening today is this. Now whether I have a barber shop here or not, comes up in the Google Map because I put it there or somebody else who is with the shop puts it there. So it should be permitted.
Hi, my name is Devangshu. I write for a newspaper called the Business Standard. Sir, I wanted to ask you about future-proofing. What do you do about location data and Internet of Things data, which is, according to a large organization which was referred to but not named, going to be a 20,000 crore market in the next year or so? How do you future-proof?
Yeah, the point is this. Let's go down to the basics. Is the data mine? Do I have a control on the data? Then I don't care whether you're a 2 billion operator or 200 billion operator. You shall not do anything to my data without taking my permission. That is the bottom line. Now, on the bottom line, what kind of superstructure you want to build is again up to the manner in which Parliament debates it.
Location.
Everything. My location is my privacy. Why should I tell you where I go on a particular day? Otherwise, my wife will give me hell.
Okay, so there's a question from the audience. from the audience. What is your opinion on the Ministry of IT denying access to minutes of meetings and submissions of people to your committee?
Government takes a long time to get over its inertia. Now, I suppose RBI application was made, no?
Yeah.
It was rejected.
Yes.
No, but one thing is there. With regard to a work in process, it's unfair to ask every time and say what is happening. But once it is over, it should be available. Now it should be available. There is no difficulty.
Apparently there is.
There was a whole series of appellate authorities, second appeal, third appeal, Supreme Court, and God himself.
Hello, sir. My name is Sushovan. I'm with the Quint. My question is, so we spoke about how the government plans to treat data, which is data as a public good, and which it has now, you know, made public by stating it in the Economic Survey of India and other places. My question to you is, sir, I want to know your thoughts on the fact that we don't have the data protection bill yet in Parliament, but at the same time, we are seeing very specific actions being taken pertaining to our data. I'll give two examples. One is the decision to sell vehicle registration and driving license bulk data by the Ministry of Transport, and the other is something like the automated facial recognition system proposed by the NCRB, which involves the data of citizens, but in the absence, what is happening is all in the absence of a data protection bill, and it has been a year. So how do you see this action, you know, of, you know, so much policy and rules being sort of implemented in this regard, but in the absence of a data protection bill?
In the absence of the law, they're doing it wrongly. What happened with the data privacy came from Puttaswamy. Before that, nobody debated. There were stray references by the Supreme Court. Now, this was happening regularly. Data was being collected by the government regularly. So how did you oppose it at that time? Oppose it at the same time. Therefore, build up pressure to say that you pass the law, that you have an overwhelming majority, and that you can just like ATM machine, if the bill goes in and comes out as well. I mean, such a complex subject. You'll also get just a more, see what happens in Monday, it will be passed. But only question is, what is the form in which it will be passed? There's a very famous Sanskrit saying. It says, Vinayakam prakurvano rajayamasa vanaram. The person started to make a Ganpati, Ganesh out of it, and what turned out to be a monkey. Let's hope that we are not made monkeys ultimately.
Yeah, I think,
Deepak,
so you had a question and then I'll take one more from
Deepak. And my question is, beyond other issues related to linking of databases, etc., isn't it odd that Aadhaar, which is for which the basic need is about a resident, whereas voting, which is about citizens?
Mm.
And how do you see this?
I don't see that. According to me, this kind of thinking, in fact, the Supreme Court is right now hearing the petition on that. They have, in fact, given a date, I think, it was moved. It's been moved by the Supreme Court.
Delhi High Court,
not Supreme. Yes, that is the most dangerous situation. It's not that this data was not available with the Election Commission. The Election Commission had it. But then the Election Commission did not have access to other data. So they had only data probably of my name, address, and family members' names, and sex, and age, and something of that sort. But now, if you add it to Aadhaar, and Aadhaar adds it to my bank account, and all the money that I had in Mauritius will also know. That's a dangerous situation, actually.
Okay, I'll just read out both the questions and so you can answer them together maybe. The first is that the bill emphasizes consent, obviously, but how will we operationalize this in the Indian context, and will it end up like Aadhaar, which means no consent, no service? And the other one is more broadly on the narrative of free and fair digital economy, which was the title of the report. And the question is more like, why was the focus on digital economy as well, as opposed to a singular focus on the right to privacy?
The focus is on digital economy because thanks to the emphasis on digitization in every field, economy is going to be impacted by digitalization, whether it is this department, that department, including the law and judiciary, including the courts are going to be digitized one day or the other. Therefore, the emphasis was on that, rightly so. But then the question is, digitization and right to privacy are seen something like antithetical concepts. So even assuming that they are antithetical, where is the line to be drawn and how far should the line go? It should go nearer to the digitization or nearer to the right to privacy. That was the issue that was to be considered, and that is what the bill had, this tightrope that the bill has tried to walk on. And what's the first part of the question?
The second one was on how do you operationalize consent?
Operationalize consent. Consent is a very, I don't know how many of you remember when mutual funds started in this country, we used to have on the TV somebody saying, mutual fund, mutual fund, mutual fund. You remember that? Then till the regulator SEBI woke up from his slumber and said, you have to have so many minutes or so many seconds, articulate each word so people understand it. Now that is fine. So consent will happen like this only. Consent can be operationalized by telling the person, I need informed consent. For what purpose? How am I going to use it? How long will I use it? You have to tell the person. But in a country like ours, there are how many, 26 official languages? I don't even know whether it keeps on changing.
No, 22.
21. 21. All it doesn't matter. From 20 to 30, there are official languages. Now, each language is radically different from the other, and the person who speaks each language refuses to recognize the other language. This is the ground situation in our country. So what are you going to do? Take consent in which language? English we hate, Hindi we hate, Tamil we hate. So in which language am I going to talk to each other and take consent? This will be the big problem. Very well, we standardize some kind of a universal language and ask for consent. There are persons who don't even know what to do except that their thumb is just by impression. You give him a piece of paper, he will not be able to understand. How do you teach them to give informed consent? Therefore, the report talked of visual symbols. How do you do visual symbols? You see this, you know, one cigarette and cross somewhere. Something like that, you must make him understand in his own manner, in his own way, that he is entitled to give me consent, he is entitled to refuse consent. After making that person understand, if he says yes, consent, no, no consent. So this is going to be a very major challenge in this country. And as far as people who are educated, people who are capable of understanding the implications are concerned, you can be of even recommended something like consent dashboards and things like that. And for children up to a particular age, minority, unfortunately we couldn't change that because the age of majority for all purposes in the law is 18. No contract is valid unless a minor enters into it. Therefore, parental consent, whether it is necessary at all times, parents may not be available, and children otherwise will be deprived of access to the internet when it's a fund of knowledge available. And simply saying declare your age is no good because the children are smart enough to give you a date of birth which would make him 23 years old, and even though he may be 4 years old. And the kids who are 5 years, 6 years are adept at working on the internet. So it's going to be a tough problem, but just because the Mount Everest is very difficult to climb, people have not stopped climbing it.
I'm Paranjoy Gowatagurth, I'm a journalist. Justice Srikrishna, do you think the internet should be declared as a public utility? And therefore, like utilities, it should be governed and regulated.
Then you will have a regulator sitting on your head all the time. Now, there are so many regulators. There is a SEBI, market regulator, insurance regulator, provident fund regulator, then you have Reserve Bank. Are you happy with the way in which the regulators are functioning? Actually, there is going to be a regulator in this field also. The Data Protection Authority is a regulator. So there is no question of, I think it would be a wrong idea to declare it as a public utility, because then you will have unnecessary problems. Electricity is public utility, see what is happening in Delhi. Electricity is public utility, what is happening in Chennai? They don't get electricity when they want, but they get fat bills. Now this kind of a situation is bad. At least today you can pick up your mobile and then carry on your conversation or carry on your communication with somebody. If it becomes a part of public utility, you have had it. You will have greater surveillance, you will have greater restraint on your freedom.
Can I ask you a related question,
yes?
A follow-up question?
Yes.
It's on.
Okay.
Yes.
That's a mic that I use.
Yeah. The world over today, two giant conglomerates, Alphabet, which includes Google, YouTube, and the operating system called Android. Another one called Facebook, which includes WhatsApp and Instagram. They account, some say 80, some say 90% of all the information that flows over the internet. There are movements to say this is bad for human society. They should be fragmented and broken up. What are your views?
That's always the case, no? Monopoly in the hands of anybody, the competition law should be applied to them. One day it will come up. Just wait. Competition is not necessarily in terms of money only. How the market is being abused, how your dominance in the market is going to make difficulties for the consumers. I'm sure people like you can move the Competition Commission, somebody will take it up seriously.
It's already been moved.
Fair enough. Good luck to you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Srikrishna, for sort of a riveting conversation, for being so feisty and engaging with a whole lot of issues, some scary issues, some not so scary. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, Seema. Thank you, Justice Srikrishna. And I think one of the best things about today has been that people have come from civil society, academia, expert groups have come, and you've had a person who's drafted the data protection bill. A lot of us have filed RTS, a lot of us have annoyed him, a lot of us have criticized him very strongly, and this openness to engagement is what will actually further greater trust and hopefully will also help spur a stronger data protection law in India, which is user-centric, strong, just not because it will be brittle. In terms of closing remarks, I just had a small thing prepared. For the things we have handed out, it has a t-shirt which reads as Digital Swaraj. And you may be questioning why it is called Digital Swaraj, because if you look at the Hind Swaraj by itself, it's an anti-technology manifesto. It talks about several things which are so critical about technology, but even states it illogically. It's anti-science to some extent. So here, there's this fascinating book I've been reading by David Allen, who says Gandhi after 9/11, and he also deals with what is the conversation between Tagore and Gandhi after an earthquake in Bihar, in which Gandhi says that people have died for their sins. And Tagore says, you're nuts. Okay, but this is what David Allen walks towards eventually. He says that both the Hind Swaraj and Tagore's correspondences with Gandhi, and this is in a book called The Mahatma and Poet, it's about viewing technology as an instrumentality. And he then further refers to Tagore's play. It's a dance play, it's called Rakta Karabi. It's about the royal king of Yaksapuri, in which human beings are basically reduced to tools in a larger government apparatus. And in fact, they're numbered as 47A, 269F. And it also has a love story. And love can't happen because people are machines in a larger apparatus. And this is basically the larger danger which we are facing today. As we are keying feverishly into our smartphones, running our lives via the calendars, and basically even forgetting directions to where we used to drive by because we are so accustomed to maps. Who is serving whom, and is technology an instrumentality? Here I would like to read a small message by Usha Ramanathan, a person we all follow, a person a lot of us admire. She says, privacy is not dead, it is being assassinated and denuded. The poor of the right are being dealt the first blow of it. The labor of many led to the privacy judgment. Now we have to our work cut out more for us to save privacy from profit and power. And I think that should be the concluding line for today. It's a continuing engagement. 2 years is a very short lifetime for any constitutional court judgment. It builds. it evolves, as Raman was saying, that this is a revolutionary process. Today would not have been possible without the partnership, the support, the leadership of Ambagak, who is at Mozilla. We are thankful to Mozilla, and this event would not have come out the way it has come out without them. I would also like to thank the Internet Freedom Foundation, our trustees, who not only advise but execute on projects. Raman is here in person. We have trustees who are technologists, who work in technology companies. That's Arvind, that's Karthik, and we have campaigners also, Rachita, who makes sanitary panels. We have a diverse group of trustees who are actively making sure that this intersection of fundamental rights and technology is not only on a case-to-case basis, but is also on a person-to-person basis, because people need to know what privacy is. Finally, I would like to thank my colleagues who have shown great support and have made sure that all your goodie packs have everything in them. That's Joanne, Devdatta, Shruti, Rishabh, and Jatin. We are all around here. Let's have the excellent ISC catering and some drinks and food. And we are all here to have more conversations with you. Thank you so much for coming.